Well, good morning, Geneva School. This is Easter Day 25, and it is my pleasure to bring morning devotions to you. As you turn in your book, please do so to page 378 and hear this invitation from God who invites us into his presence. Wake up, sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Our Bible passage from the Old Testament today is portions of Psalm 89. I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. With my mouth, I will make your faithfulness known through all generations. I will declare that your love stands firm forever, that you have established your faithfulness in heaven itself. The heavens praise your wonders, Lord, your faithfulness too. In the assembly of the holy ones. For who in the skies above can compare with the Lord? Who is like the Lord among the heavenly beings? In the council of the holy ones, God is greatly feared. He is more awesome than all who surround him. Who is like you, Lord God Almighty? You, Lord, are mighty, and your faithfulness surrounds you. Lord, where is your former great love, which in your faithfulness you swore to David? Remember, Lord, how your servant has been mocked, how I bear in my heart the taunts of all the nations, the taunts with which your enemies, Lord, have mocked, with which they have mocked every step of your anointed one. Praise be the Lord forever. Amen and amen. Our Bible reading today continues from the previous several days from the Gospel according to St. John, chapter 10, and we read these verses beginning in verse 24. The Jews who were there gathered around him saying, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you're the Messiah, tell us plainly." Jesus answered, "I did tell you, but you did not believe. The works I do in my Father's name testify about me, but you do not believe because you are not my sheep. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and the Father are one." Well, folks, this is a wonderful passage. And out of the many remarks that could be said, I want to try something a little bit different this morning. And what I'd like to do is I'd like to draw our attention to hands. Yes, hands, just like these. Hands. People's hands are all unique. And as much as hands are unique, we know that every set of fingerprints is unique. With 7 billion people on the face of the earth, no one has exactly the same fingerprint that you have or that I have. That's a remarkable feature. And so I'm fascinated by looking at people's hands. You know, hands, they tell a story. They reveal quite a bit about a person, and they contain a history of that individual within them, almost like the rings inside, you know, a tree trunk tell the story of how the tree itself has grown and matured. And so I'd like for you to think this morning about a couple different sets of hands. First of all, they're the rough-hewn hands of a laborer. They may be somewhat scarred, perhaps sunburned from working outside for decades upon decades. And we know that a laborer's hands like that have become very sinewy and strong from decades of craftsmanship. And then there are the hands of an artist, whether a pianist, a sculptor, or a painter, Their hands seem to be unusually deft, gentle, and they have become very amenable to the artistry that is asked of them. Thirdly, let's think about the hands of a newborn infant, how they are just so perfectly formed, so delicate, so small, tiny, and fragile, and yet they're so complete. I mean, you can even see the wrinkles on each one of the knuckles, and you can see and feel just how soft and delicate their fingernails still are. Well, we could name any number of additional types of hands, but now I want to draw your attention to God's hands. Let's think again about what rough-hewn hands God might have. For you know, he fashioned the cosmos in all of its materiality, the Bible says, with his hands. He formed hundreds of billions of stars, each one a mass of hot gas, eventually becoming lustrous suns. The Bible says that each one of these things in the heavens are the playthings of God's fingers, that he created them and set them in their courses, and that his power and majesty, his unbelievable aspect of his character is such that the entire cosmos are just little playthings for his fingers. And so in a sense, God is in fact the ultimate craftsman who set the pillars of the earth. He bound the Pleiades. He drew the boundaries of the sea, saying to the sea, thus far shall you come and no further. But let's look at the artistic hands of God that were at work. Because you see, it is those same hands that, having fashioned the material universe, then created the artistry of the music of the spheres. With those hands, he painted and continues to paint the sky with unimaginable hues of colors. And with those hands, he sculpted Adam and Eve from the humus, turning dust into an image of his own glory in the persons of Adam and Eve. And then there are his newborn hands, that is, the tiny, delicate fingers of the incarnate Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. How these delicate fingers playing in the soft folds of Mary's robe must have led her to muse how it was that these tiny little fingers actually fashioned the cosmos in all of its immensity and power. And how could it be that she, there holding the baby Jesus in her lap, was holding the hand of God incarnate? The Bible tells us that Mary, pondering all these things, treasured them in her heart. Well, these are the hands of God, delicate, artistic, rough-hewn and sinewy, with strength that guarantees, as our Bible passage tells us today, that no man, no one, no thing could ever snatch us out of those hands. He tells us that we are his sheep, and he is the good shepherd, and that he will be our overseer, our guardian, our protector. And that those that he keeps in his hands, he will surely keep. He says again that there is no man who could ever snatch us or steal us or pull us away from him, because having loved us, he secures us in that love in these hands of his that will not let us go. You know, the Apostle Paul speaks about this in Romans chapter 8 when he asks this question: who can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord? And he asks the question, in a sense, who could snatch us out of God's hands is essentially what he's saying. And he answers his own question. He says, you know, neither life nor death, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers of any kind could ever take us away and separate us from the love of God in Christ. Folks, that's a wonderful promise. That is a guarantee from our God that his hands are capable of holding us secure in his love throughout the entirety of our life. In fact, if we looked hard enough, we might even be able to see the nail prints in his hands that would actually further guarantee that God is true to his word and will fulfill all of his promises of the security of his love that is given to us when we become a faithful disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so this morning, as we think about this passage, I guess the appropriate way to end is to say the words that Jesus himself, as he hung on the cross, said to his Father when he ended his earthly life by saying, "Father, into thy hands we commend our spirit." And with that this morning, I encourage us now to muse on that, to think on it, and to ponder it, even as Mary treasured truths like this and hid them in her heart. So I would encourage you to hide these truths in your heart today and to think about how Jesus has made this promise regarding his Father and our security in him. Well, let us continue this morning and recite the prayer that is printed on page 379 that reads like this. Faithful Savior, I am so grateful for your commitment to me that will never let me be snatched away from you. I falter in my faith and feel the pull away from you by the siren call of sin and temptation. But you keep me standing in grace, strengthened and powerfully preserved. Fill me with your spirit to fight the good fight today. And all God's people said, Amen. Hear now this blessing as we conclude this morning. Now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, may he equip you with everything good for doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. My friends, have a good day.